Okay, I think we can start. I would like to welcome our next speaker on stage, Harald. He'll give us a session about IoT. So, Harald, you have the word.
Okay, so thank you for the introduction. My name is Harald Meyer. I'm coming from Software AG, and I'm the lead IoT architect there, which basically means that I'm working with a lot of different customers and projects, mainly in the early phases, to get them up and running, to make sure that they are following a sane architecture, and basically then move on to the next project. What I want to talk to you about today is IoT, and especially that actually, if you think about IoT, really, it's not really that much about the things. So the things or devices have actually always been there. So they might have been bigger, they might have been servers, and now we might have smaller things, but essentially it's the same kind of things that we want to connect. And the interesting thing is actually what comes afterwards is what you do with the data that you get from your devices. So what can you do with measurements or alerts coming from devices? And that's basically what my talk today is about. The first question, of course, is what really is IoT? Because if you actually look at the whole landscape, you can't really say it's about small things, because yes, we have small things which are essentially just very small computers with a few sensors. But if you think about IoT in the industrial environment, actually we are talking about bigger industrial PCs, which essentially are servers. So basically the devices are not that much different from a standard server. The only thing is that they have more inputs coming into them. So it's not just requests coming from other IT systems, but it's also measurements coming from sensors, for example, or from actors, so somebody pushing a button. And really defining IoT in that area can be quite hard. So what I want to do is I just want to give you three brief examples what IoT projects can look like, so that you can get a feeling of what's typical for them. And then what we will do is we will look at a common process for all of them and look at the different components which are involved in each of these steps, what your architectural choices there are, and how to actually implement this in the project. So the first case, that's actually one of the first areas where we started, because Software AG is traditionally actually pretty strong in the insurance business and in the banking business. So here the idea originally coming from car insurances is that you actually want to monitor the drivers. So you want to make sure that they are not driving too fast or braking too strongly. You also want to measure how much they actually drive. And the idea behind that is that you can actually tailor your insurance products to a specific customer group. So for example, you might have a customer who's only driving very seldom and who's also driving very carefully. So you might want to offer them a different contract, a cheaper contract than somebody who's driving all the time, who might be speeding, braking too hard. And in that way, this enables insurances to reduce their business risks and thereby also reducing the premiums that the customers have to pay. You can think about quite a few different similar scenarios in different insurances. So, for example, you might monitor the health of somebody, so somebody might have to pay less for health insurance if they are moving more than 10,000 steps a day, if they keep their blood pressure low. You might also use it to actually monitor that the conditions that somebody promised to you are actually intact. So for example, yes, I have a home alarm system and it's actually working, or yes, that expensive goods that have been transported have actually been kept in the agreed upon temperature range. So this all enables you, by putting small devices onto these things, to make the business of insurance less risky for the insurance, but also give some benefits at least to some of their customers. A different use case that we've seen quite often is smart city. So here the idea is basically public authorities like cities or countries even have a lot of different services that they have to provide, and they can be quite ineffective in doing that. So in a very basic example, clearing out waste baskets. So when do you actually have to clear it out? Of course, you only have to do it when it's full. But how do you know when it's actually full? So, so you have to know when it's actually full, because otherwise you might have a fixed schedule, which might mean that some waste baskets are cleared out too often. And on the other hand, if you have a waste basket in a park, for example, and the weather is nice, they might already be full on Saturday evening, and everybody who goes there on Sunday would just throw their trash to the ground, which for you as a city makes it much more expensive to actually clean it out again on Monday morning. So it might actually make sense for you as a city to send somebody on Saturday evening or Sunday morning to already clear out the waste baskets. And similar things you can have for the lighting in the city. So instead of putting the lights on in parts of the city which are actually very seldom traveled during the night, you might automatically detect a few hundred meters before somebody arrives on foot or by car, and only then switch on the lights dynamically. So quite a few different use cases here, which if they are properly implemented, can actually make the services cheaper and also better that a city provides. And the last example I want to show you is actually where at least we have seen the most traction, which is in the industrial IoT environment. So here, basically, the whole story is traditionally, you have the IT, and in manufacturing, you have something called OT, or operational technology. So that's basically about everything that's running in your plant that controls machines or open and closes valves. And traditionally, these two sectors have been very much kept separate from each other. And part of the industrial IoT story is to actually bring these two together. So to actually get the input that, for example, a valve was closed, or about temperature readings from the machines, into your IT systems, so that you can quickly present it on a dashboard, for example, for workers or for managers to see. And what you then can also do are these three example use cases here. So basically, the one that we've seen the most is predictive maintenance. So the whole idea behind that is, instead of doing maintenance on fixed schedules, like doing it every 6 months, because you know if you don't do it after 5 months, most machines will break down. But if you do it too frequently, you're wasting your resources. So here the idea is you are taking measurements like temperatures, like pressures, and you learn from your historic data. So you know that in the past, when this temperature increased by at least 2 degrees Celsius, and that pressure here increased, this is a situation which most likely will lead to a failure in the next 2 weeks. So with predictive maintenance, you would say, I'm still doing scheduled maintenance, but I'm doing them less frequently. And at the same time, I'm doing it when the system actually tells me that I need to do it. Similar area is predictive quality management, but here you are not actually looking at your machines and how they work, but you look at what's coming out of the machines, so at your products, at the quality of the products, and the throughput that you get. And if you see here that the output is decreasing, you can proactively do something about it. Again, maybe do maintenance. Maybe the problem is with some of the workers, so you have to do some training maybe to make sure that they are adhering to the proper procedures. But essentially, you can quickly detect problems before they become big problems. And a similar thing that we've seen with our customers is actually the customer of our customers. So quite often you have the case that you have a big machine manufacturer and they actually have customers who are very small. So they might just own one or two machines and they don't have the proper know-how to maintain that machine or to update the machine. And essentially what happens is that the manufacturer of the machine will continue to do the maintenance and the management of the machine for their actual customer. And at the moment, what this means is that they essentially have to send somebody out to their customers if something goes wrong or on fixed maintenance schedules, which, again, is not the best approach to use their resources. If they connect this using the internet, they can actually in their system see all their customer machines, learn actually across different machines what might be problematic situations. So a situation that has occurred at two or three customers working in Thailand, for example, which actually the machine manufacturer who has built the machine in Germany never experienced before and never seen with a German customer. And it might be a problem related to the humidity or the heat in that area. So they can quickly see problems and they can also schedule maintenance then in such a way that they can go to multiple customers in one trip proactively instead of just going there once the machine has failed, basically. So this is a quick overview of different use cases. And this diagram is essentially an abstraction of the whole thing. So what's similar in all of these different use cases? Similar is you have devices here on the left-hand side, which typically are not in the same location, and they are not completely reliable. So they might be disconnected. They might sometimes not return answers. And from these different machines, you actually get events, which you have to aggregate in your platform. And in that platform, what you then do is you have to sort the events to get them into the right order. You want to detect patterns in there. So for example, if the pressure increases after the temperature increased, that might mean something for you. You might want to calculate averages, and you might want to see missing events. With all of that information, you typically will be able to detect a situation which might be extremely good for you or extremely bad for you. And then in the last step, you want to tell somebody about this. So either you show it in the dashboard or you alert somebody if it's a really bad thing, or you trigger, for example, a business process so that you send somebody out for maintenance, or what you can also do is you can give feedback to the actual machines. Here, this is actually one important thing. So if you speak with IT guys, they typically think, oh yes, feedback to the machines means I send an action to a machine to close a valve, for example. If you speak with the machine guys, they say, no, we don't want to do that via an IT system because it's way too unreliable and it's not fast enough for me. So typically, the actual controlling of manufacturing processes is something that you would not do on the IoT system, but that's something that remains on the OT system, which is already there. And you typically just provide alarms here, for example, for some human to react. But you don't do something which has to close a valve in a few milliseconds, for example. Okay. You don't have to actually read this. You can't even read it if you would be right in front of my screen. What this is an overview that a company did of all the different IoT players. So you can see there's a lot of different companies in here. And if you have very good eyes in the middle row on the left-hand side, you could actually see Software AG together with SAP. These are what is called the full stack platforms. And even if you have one of these, you still wouldn't be able to just work with this one vendor, because there are still things which this one vendor doesn't do. For example, we don't do hardware, which you can see in the bottom row, and we also don't do payment and quite a few other things. So essentially, the takeaway from here, and this is also what Gartner says, is you will always have to assemble your IoT solution from different components, from different vendors, open source, closed source, build them yourself sometimes even. And it's very unlikely that you will find a complete solution which solves all your problems. And what I want to tell you in the rest of my talk today about is the IoT process, which essentially is a standardized flow similar to the one that you've seen a few slides ago through an IoT system with the different functions that play a role in such a process. And this is how it looks like. So again, it goes from left to right. And on the left-hand side, it starts with the actual devices. And these devices have to be connected to the platform. And then the first step you actually do is you do an integration step. And what you do there is you typically do some cross-referencing with back-end data. So for example, in the event that you get from your device, you only have the device ID, but you don't have the customer ID, which comes from your ERP backend system, for example. Or if we are in the production environment, you have to correlate the event that you get here with information about a production batch coming from your manufacturing execution system, the MES there at the bottom. So you have to do some aggregation of your raw events so that they're actually usable for you. And what you then do is you do the main part, the streaming analytics there at the top, which goes through the stream of events to detect situations which are of interest for you. And then if you have done that and you have found an interesting situation, you go to the actions tab in the end, which means that you start a BPM process, for example, or you have an alert, or you have a human actually see something, or you call an external system. So that's the main flow. in the bottom of the screen, you can see the batch part of the process. So typically, when we talk about IoT, we are talking about streaming. So we take the live events as they come and process them. But that's not always what you want to do or what you actually can do. So in some cases, you have to do the batch analytics to do, for example, daily reports at the end of the day. And that's what the bottom layer is about. And in between, you have a visualization part so that humans can actually see something. And you have two stores here. So you have the actual store, which typically will store the events in one form or another. And you have the in-memory store, which is typically used as a cache. So for example, if you are if you're doing the cross-referencing with customer IDs, you typically don't want to go back to your ERP system for each individual message, because then you might be overloading your ERP system. But you would do that once and then actually cache the ID and only do the lookup via such an in-memory system. So that's from a high-level point of process, and I'm now going through the different steps and explain to you what these steps actually mean. So the first part, which I labeled here the easy part, is device connectivity and management. And actually, it's not that easy because, for example, for device connectivity, it's not like you can take just any device and plug it into your system and it works, because it's using the same standard like everybody else. But there are dozens upon dozens of different protocols here. So there are standardized protocols for messaging like MQTT or AMQP, which are often used. But quite often, you have custom binary protocols. You have other industry-specific standards like Cloud Fieldbus or OPC UA. So typically, the first step actually is to figure out how your devices can communicate with the system, and then making sure that it can actually communicate. So quite often in our projects, we do agent development in the beginning, so to actually connect the system. And then you have these other choices. So does the device actively connect to the server and push the data out? Or does the server connect to the device and pull the data? There are advantages and disadvantages for both of them. And we see both of them quite frequently. Then you have cases, then you have edge cases. So here, the idea is quite often you don't want to connect all your individual machines directly with your IoT platform, because your IoT platform is centrally hosted, and putting all the events into that platform might not be the sensible approach. So typically, you will have a small edge server running in a plant, for example, which does pre-aggregation of the data, and then only feedback the aggregated data back to your main system. And similarly, you can have permanent connectivity, which is what most would typically expect. But if, for example, you have a sensor on a shipping container, and that shipping container goes on a journey across the Atlantic Ocean, you won't have connectivity while it's on the ocean, and you still have to deal with that. And similarly, device management. So as I've said, a typical case here is you need to manage customer environments. So you have to structure your devices hierarchically, for example, by customer and also by region. So you have to have different means here of presenting your machines and visualizing them. And then you need to be able to remotely manage them. So for example, to remotely update the firmware of a machine and still making sure that after the firmware update, the machine comes back up again and still works. Because if you do that to a customer in Thailand and you are shutting down their machine, they won't be very happy about it, and they essentially will expect that some service staff will be there the next day. So this has to just work. So again, this is the easy part. The most interesting part in most of our projects is actually the analytics part. So this is actually about finding interesting things in the stream of events. And here I did a rough classification according to two dimensions. So the first one, left to right, is am I streaming the events? So am I working on events as they occur? Or am I working on data that is already at rest? So essentially big data. And the second dimension is up and down. Am I working with fixed rules that I have to come up myself? Or am I working with a machine learning approach so that I can do some kind of training and hopefully have the system be smart enough to figure something out for me? And I'll go through each of them one by one. So the first one, this is working with streaming data, but with fixed rules. So here the idea is, I have a stream of events, which are these gray, these small gray cubes. And then we have these red cubes in there, which are events of interest. And here we actually detected a pattern of three different events, which occurred in a small time window, and which all three indicated that the temperature of a certain sensor was above a threshold. And we explicitly said in a rule, if this happens, raise an alert, because this is a situation which is a problem. Typically, you have different ways of doing these things. So you can have time and location-based windows, so saying events happening in 1 minute or in a certain area. You do grouping or aggregation, so you calculate averages or find min and max values, and you do relationships between events. So, for example, if event A comes before event B, it's a problem. And finally, you can do event enrichment, where you actually take data coming, for example, from this in-memory cache to put additional information into these events. Okay, so this is the first example where you do the pattern matching. So you are looking at specific events and say, I have one event which says that the temperature is above 95 degrees Celsius and the valve is at least half open. That's a situation where I want to raise an alarm, for example. So this is one pattern that you can do. So you have two events, one for the valve, one for the temperature, and if they happen in a specific time frame, you raise an alarm. Similarly, you can have aggregations. So here, we're actually saying aggregate all the temperature measurements in 2 windows, in 2 minutes, calculate the average, and send the average out as a new event. And finally, you can actually combine these two together. So you're actually looking, for example, only at the valve opening and closing as individual events. And for the temperature readings, you would actually look at the aggregated values, because individual values might fluctuate too much, so you wouldn't actually get any sensible information out of that. Okay, that was the first case. The second case is, again, rules-based, so you have defined your own rules that you want to follow, But instead of doing it on a stream, you do it on a batch. And here you would, for example, then ask a question like, how was the average temperature yesterday? So you would look back at historical data to calculate something of interest for you. This is something we typically don't do very much. Partially, of course, that's because we don't have a product for that. So we typically do what our products can do. But partially also because we say this is something you rarely really want to do. So typically, you actually want to work on the live data as it appears. Third approach is, again, streaming data. But now, instead of having fixed rules, you actually want to use machine learning. So for example, on the left-hand side, here you can see a rule, the same rule that we had before. But instead of yourself defining a rule saying that three measurements for the temperature sensor across a certain reading are a problem, the algorithm actually learned that from the data. So you collected a lot of historical data. You know when the machine failed. And the machine learning algorithm determined from that information that actually, if a machine failed, typically before you had these three temperature readings above the threshold. So it, essentially, the system came up with its own rule. And similarly, on the right-hand side, you can also have classifications for individual events. So this might be an event about somebody breaking in a car, and the output of the classification is whether this should be deemed a dangerous break or not. And this might not be a trivial thing if it's saying that if the person is using 100% of the brake power, it's dangerous, but it might take other things into account, like environmental factors or the location where this happened. And the last approach that I see is, again, doing the batch processing, but now doing it with the same machine learning approaches. So this can be actually used in two different kind of ways. So the first way is to actually really work on the batch data to find something interesting. So for example, either use machine learning approaches or use classical data mining approaches to find interesting information from the large data set. Or this can actually be the input for your intelligent streaming approach. So for the if you want to use machine learning, in essentially all the cases that work very well, you need some kind of training data before that. And ideally, that training data also needs to be classified. So you need to know, this is a problem, this is okay, this is a problem, and so on. Because otherwise, these algorithms can't work. There are a few other things like unsupervised learning, which do some of these things themselves. But the things that work best are the ones that work on classified data. And that's what you could use this batch data here for. Okay, so that's the analytics part. So if we look at storage, there are actually quite a few areas where you want to store data. So on the left-hand side, actually out of the scope typically of our system is the enterprise systems and the databases that you are using. So that's something that you just take as it is. And you just have to have a way to interface with them. And then what you typically have in your IoT application, you have some kind of data lake, which essentially is a fancy way of just saying throwing your data into a big bucket without thinking too much about structuring it, and then hoping to find something out of that information later on. And you have your in-memory caches where you store reference and master data. Okay, so for the actions part, here the question is, what are the actions that you typically need in an IoT project? And there are quite a few different ways of doing things. So you might start with dashboards. So these are essentially read-only visualizations of the data, typically giving workers or managers a quick overview of how the system operates. It might have some additional drill-down capabilities, but you can't really do much from that. But the benefits of that is that this can typically, with most IoT platforms, be built in a couple of minutes. So you just take a few existing widgets which can work with the data of your IoT platform and arrange all the data in such a way that makes sense for you. If you have to have some kind of interaction, you typically have to have additional user interfaces, and these have to be custom built. So these are web applications using the same APIs, but typically not built from a fixed set of widgets. And alerts, again, is something the platform typically gives you. And another thing that we've seen quite a bit of interest in is other forms of interaction. So we've done a few things with Amazon Alexa. So instead of having to type and then look at a screen to find the information, you can actually ask Alexa for example, are there any problems in the system? What are certain sensor readings? Of course, this doesn't always make sense. So if you are on a shop floor, which is very loud, this typically will not work. But in other areas where people might not have their hands free, it's a good way of getting people to quickly interact with systems. And so that's the user interaction. And the other actions that you want to trigger is actions in the backend system. And that's actually quite important and often forgotten, because it's all nice that you can see something on the dashboard, that you can raise alarms. But if you're actually looking at large companies, what's interesting for them is they want to, for example, start a process automatically if a certain condition applies. Or they want to call some backend system to trigger something there. So this integration aspect is quite important in typical IoT projects. And finally, you want to trigger actions on devices. As I said, this is typically not to control production processes, but on a higher level. So for example, we have a situation where we have a customer doing remote administration on the devices that they use, and they have to make sure when that maintenance occurs that the machine is actually shut down. So, and this is actually a two-step process. So the maintenance worker actually can physically stop the machine, so that actually when they are on site, they can make sure that the machine is no longer working. But at the same time, you want to do the same already in the platform. So as an automated step, before the maintenance worker arrives, already shut down the machine, and then basically what the worker does is only a safeguard, so that essentially you have twice the security, because you have two completely different security mechanisms done by two different persons. So you can be much sure that the machine is actually physically turned off. Okay, so that's the process. I have one slide for a bit of marketing about our products, but it's the only one. And afterwards, I'll come to the summary. So this is actually our platform called Cumulosity IoT. It's if you want to try it out, you can go to cumulosity.com and get a 30-day cloud instance to test it out. And essentially, all the steps that I presented before to you are things that you can do with the Cumulosity IoT platform. So starting from the devices, we have connected 100 plus different kinds of devices, starting from small Raspberry Pis so that you can connect them yourself, or we have applications running on your mobile phone using the sensors that are in your mobile phone, up to big industrial PCs. So we have a partnership with Dell, for example, for their industry PCs. And you can quite quickly develop your own agents to connect your own kinds of devices here. We have different ways of doing analytics. So we have some extremely basic things where you just visually click rules together, and we have a full-fledged streaming analytics engine in the background doing that, which you can also program directly. We have integration with the backend systems. That's what I stressed earlier, and I stressed this because that's where we historically have a lot of know-how. So we have something called Web Methods, which is an, depending on how old you are, you call it an ESB or EAI product or whatever you want to call it. And nowadays, it's actually also supporting microservices, so whatever you fancy. And that's quite important here. Then we have a simple way of doing case management in that application so that you can actually manage alarms coming up and have people actually complete them. And we can also, again, combine this with our BPM platform so that you can actually have complex processes running here. And finally, we have a few prepackaged accelerators for different industries. For example, for the logistics industry, a track and trace solution, which you can quickly take and basically monitor your logistics processes. OK, so last slide to sum up what I wanted to tell you about today. As I said, IoT isn't really that much about the devices, but it's actually about the rest of the process. So how you do analytics, so how can you find interesting things about the data that your devices collect? How do you store the data? How can you retrieve the data that you have stored in a sensible manner? And then finally, how can you actually trigger some meaningful actions based on what you found out in your data, and how can you visualize these things in a manner that's that makes sense to the people using the system. Okay, so I'm a bit ahead of time. Do we have any questions? Okay, then I could have had two or three additional marketing slides, but as I don't have them in my slide deck, and I think you're probably happy about that, I think we can have probably a bit longer break for all of you today. Okay, so thank you.